Events are taking place across New Hampshire this week in honor of Juneteenth. While President Biden only signed the holiday into law in 2021, the celebration goes back to 1890. What is Juneteenth? We'll talk about that and more now on The State We're In. Hello, welcome to The State We're In. I'm Melanie Plenda. This week, we celebrate Juneteenth. Some events have already taken place with more to come over the next few days. What is this newly recognized federal holiday and day of observance in New Hampshire all about? Joining us today are JerriAnne Boggis, Executive Director of Black Heritage Trail New Hampshire, Dwight Davis, owner, senior helpers of Southern New Hampshire, and past president of Black Heritage Trail New Hampshire, and James McKim, NAACP Manchester Branch President and Managing Partner at Organizational Ignition, LLC. Welcome to you all. So, JerriAnne, what is the history behind Juneteenth?
So, Juneteenth is a predominantly Black celebration where it started in Texas as a result of General George Granger. He led Union soldiers into Galveston, Texas on June 19, 1865. We know this is 2 years after President Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation. But it would take this army that General Granger brought into Galveston, Texas to free the enslaved people in Texas. It's not that the enslaved people there didn't know that the Emancipation Proclamation had been signed on January 1st, 1863. It's just that the enslavers did not obey that new Emancipation Proclamation. So they had to, it would take this army to force the enslavers to free the enslaved people there. Also, too, just to put this in perspective, the Emancipation Proclamation that President Lincoln signed did not free all the slaves. It was only the slaves that were in the states that wanted to secede that they were free. So that meant that states like Delaware, the District of Columbia, Kentucky, Maryland, and Missouri still had enslaved people as well. So it wasn't just slavery didn't end with the Emancipation Proclamation. So with June 19 then represents this emancipation for when freedom really ended for Black the enslaved African-Americans in our country.
Dwight, Texas was the last state where enslaved people were proclaimed free, and the Juneteenth commemoration has been a state holiday since 1980. Your career in the NBA took you to many places, including Texas. So I'm interested in how you would compare your experiences in other states versus living in New Hampshire, and how is the observance of Juneteenth different?
Thank you, Melanie. I'd like to first add on to what JerriAnne spoke about, the proclamation of slaves in Texas being announced free by General Granger. During the war, as the war progressed, even after the proclamation, many slave owners, they either took or shipped many of their slaves to Texas because as the war was fought town by town, state by state, Texas was the southernmost state. And of course, many Southerners were trying to resist and they held out hope that there would be some change or there would be a state that could be held as a slave state going on. And that's why you had so many slaves congregated in the state of Texas. And that's why the resistance was so strong, and thus the final proclamation on Juneteenth. To answer your question about Juneteenth being a holiday in Texas, actually it was a proclamation back in 1936. When I did some studying, I was quite surprised because during 1936, Texas was still very much an oppressor state for people of color, but it did not become a state holiday until 1980. However, Black folk in Texas did not wait till 1980 to start celebrating Juneteenth. I can remember from my birth in 1949 as a young kid in the early and mid 50s, it was a huge, huge holiday. And as a young person, I thought it was celebrated in all states likewise. But you're right, Melanie, it was not celebrated in all states likewise. One of the states I moved to and lived in playing with the Cleveland Cavaliers was Ohio. It was celebrated to a small extent in Ohio, but not to a large extent. And I was quite surprised as a 21-year-old man. Later on, I was traded to the Golden State Warriors in California. And California has a lot of folks who have moved from Texas to California, probably because of climate and so forth, was similar to Texas. And also because of moving west, people felt that the dream of real freedom and opportunity was there. But it was celebrated largely in California, not quite as large as Texas, but largely.
And so compared to, so it sounds like, I know that we only just recently in New Hampshire started kind of, at least we won't, I've only noticed the sort of pickup in the celebrations. And I do feel like it seems like it's grown over the last few years in particular. What are your observations of that, Ben? How is it different in terms of how it's celebrated here and in the other places that you've been?
Thank you, Melanie, for that help in prompting me to finish answering your question. Huge, huge difference. I've been in New Hampshire now 20 years. When I first arrived in New Hampshire 20 years ago, it was not even spoken of by people that I knew here. Even though my wife and I, we celebrated it and we introduced it, as a matter of fact, to a lot of our friends and our close circles. Over the years, as I got to know JerriAnne, and JerriAnne celebrated it, and with the work she's doing with the trail, we began to help get the word out and encourage it, and the NAACP folks, because again, in most states where you do find Juneteenth being celebrated, it's because people of Texas, they migrated from Texas to places in the North. It's taken on some significance here with a lot of help from the Black Heritage Trail, from the NAACP and some other Black organizations. And it is changing the minds and the face of New Hampshire, slowly but surely.
Just one follow-up question to that. And for folks who still might be still learning about Juneteenth and as a holiday, as a celebration, are there any traditions associated with Juneteenth as other holidays?
Well, for sure, there is the drinking of red soda water is a traditional thing. Peach cobbler, a banana pudding, a barbecue, of course, because you know barbecue in Texas is all things celebratory. There's also their readings in churches and community buildings where people gather. There are collections of people in parks of Black folk and even white folks. We collect in the parks and we have a big barbecue and we dance and we sing and we play games.
Wonderful. And James, reflecting on the protracted struggle for an official state holiday to honor Martin Luther King Jr. in New Hampshire, has the NAACP advocated to make Juneteenth a state holiday? And do you think such a measure would have support?
Well, thank you. We have advocated for it, and I think there is support for it. I think that support is challenged, though, especially because of the times in which we live. We have a backlash against learning the true history of this nation, and covering up the fact that we had slavery as an institution here in the United States. I think, unfortunately, a number of folks in our legislature are afraid of that history. And so I think there is support for it, but I think it would be, it's a long haul to actually have it passed as an official holiday here in the state.
JerriAnne, this year's Juneteenth celebration presented by Black Heritage Trail New Hampshire explores the theme of greening Black art, gateways to a more awareness. So tell us about that theme and how you feel it will advance understanding.
Sure, thank you. Before I just answer that question, I just wanted to add so that people would recognize that New Hampshire's been celebrating, not necessarily Juneteenth, but the Emancipation Day since the 1800s. The first minister of the Black Church, Reverend Austin, celebrated Emancipation Day since the 1800s at his church. And that continued. He even left an endowment so that the town, that Portsmouth, could still celebrate that. And then that turned into when there were Black organizations coming out back from the 30s, they started move that Emancipation Day to Juneteenth. And then, you know, it developed under Valerie Cunningham's work that, you know, the Portsmouth Black Heritage Trail, which the Black Heritage Trail of New Hampshire is an outgrowth organization from, that we continued the tradition that was started back in the 1800s. So New Hampshire has a long history of celebrating emancipation, not necessarily on June 19th, but now we do, since we have a good federal holiday. So to answer your question about the theme that we picked, it is when we started looking at the themes of our prior Juneteenth celebration, one of the things we realized that we've omitted in all of our work is looking at Black masculinity. And we thought that this was a good time using art and dialogue to really explore that theme of what it means to be Black male in America. And it just brought us to a really important place of looking, of really breaking down stereotypes. Our first event was a young artist named Nadraj Nina Holmes, who took an image of Gordon, known to the majority of Americans as Whipped Peter, the man with the scars, the formerly enslaved man with all the scars on his back. And he erased the scars and put other things on his back just as a starting place for a dialogue so that people can really immerse themselves in understanding what this history is, what Black male masculinity is all about. And last week, we had a discussion with 8 Black African men of color on stage in Manchester. And I tell you, it was the most emotional, engaging, transformative conversation I've been a part of, because we never allow our Black men to be vulnerable, to be emotional. And on this stage, they were authentically themselves and opened a door for us to see into what it really means to be Black, to be male in America. So I'm really excited about this theme. I think we have a lot of stuff to unpack. And with a bigger understanding, our men can be who they are themselves in our communities.
Amazing. And Dwight, as a founding member of the Business Alliance with People of Color, would you say the ability to build intergroup connections and relationships is even more important given the demographics in New Hampshire?
Melanie, you're absolutely correct. We realize as people of color that if we're going to take our rightful place in this society, in this community, that we must have more business owners. We have to have more job creators. And in order to do that effectively and efficiently, those of us who have broken through to some degree must go back and share. It's like the term Sankofa. It's not a bad thing for us to go back and share what we've learned and share our connections with others to come together and gather the full force that a group can bring as opposed to individual people of color here and there. And it has been, it's very exciting. We've seen a number of large companies wanting to come and be associate members and to work with us because they understand, like we understand, if New Hampshire is to continue to grow and grow healthy, they must accept, invite, and welcome people of color to the community.
James, in your NAACP president's message, you talk about the need to engage people of all races, creeds, and colors to achieve your mission of securing the political, educational, social, and economic equality of rights. So what are some of the ways people can get involved in Manchester or even in small towns around New Hampshire?
So Melanie, there are so many ways that people can get involved from following what is going on at the state legislature, being in touch with your representatives and letting them know that we want a state that shows equal treatment and equitable treatment to every single person, regardless of their race. You can follow what's going on in your town, with your town government, with your selectmen, with your select boards and all the various committees. Get involved in governance. School boards, getting involved in the school board, going to school board meetings and letting your thoughts and your feelings and your desires and your beliefs be known. We have a number of people who are coming into our state from outside of the state and attending school board meetings, and they have what I think is an outsized influence on what school boards are doing. So we need people locally to go to our school boards and be part of the conversation. To pick up on something Dwight said, we have a number of minority-owned businesses here in the state, and on our website, we have a list of those minority-owned businesses. So we are encouraging people to go to that list and patronize those businesses to help them to grow and to take advantage of the various products and services which enrich all of our lives by taking advantage of them. So those are a few ways. Also joining the NAACP branches, visiting the Black Heritage Trail, supporting its programs. There's so many ways, and those are just a few that people can get involved and enrich their lives by doing so.
JerriAnne, as we saw with Harriet Wilson, too often textbooks and state history curriculum overlook or even intentionally exclude significant people of color. Wentworth Cheswell is becoming a household name in Newmarket, even though scholars have written about him since the 1980s. Are there likely to be other stories waiting to be uncovered? And how would someone pursue this in their own hometown?
So I think there are so many more stories that will come. There was not a place in New Hampshire that didn't have a Black story, a Black person living. So I think we are going to find out more as we come along. Places that people can go to uncover this history includes church records. That's where Valerie Cunningham found the first record of the person that started her on her journey to find the Black history in Portsmouth. In St. John's church record, it said there was an entry that said Venus, a slave, $1. And then Valerie was off looking for other stories. In Mason, when I was looking for the history of Milford in the town history, there was a story about Bode, just written as a footnote. So looking through your town histories, the footnotes are great places to find, New Hampshire's Black history. Also, too, if you look in the around in your town for a great house, an old house that has been there, you know, the founding fathers, you can look up their stories. More than likely, they had enslaved people. So that's one another place to look. Graveyards are great places to look as well. And of course, your local historical societies will have these stories that you can look up. And there are lots of places online that we can now look to search for records of enslaved people, the genealogical sites. And it really is, if you have this passion, these stories, these places, these other people will come to you as well.
So let's talk about healing circles. On top of trauma a person of color is likely to have experienced in their own life, would you say the history of slavery lurks in the background? James, why don't you start?
Well, it obviously, it absolutely lurks in the background because we were just talking about the perception of African-Americans that JerriAnne was talking about from the event last week, and that Black men have not been allowed to be vulnerable, and they've not been allowed to be vulnerable because of this perception that Black men are dangerous, not to be trusted, not to be heard. And that's based on the enslavement, that notion that Black people are not human. It's what we really have been taught. It's been in the air that we breathe, that there's this danger. And so there's a healing that needs to go on, and not just for Black people, but for everyone, because this notion that Black people, Black males in particular, are dangerous causes fear in white people. It causes this notion that, well, we can't be safe if there's a person of color there. And even if we don't act that based on that, it's something that's going on in our heads. And this goes on in the heads of Black people too, by the way. So we all need this healing. And it's one of the reasons why we're working with Nicole Sublette, with therapists of color, to put on healing circles. These opportunities to have these deep conversations about what's broken in the relationships that have happened in the past, what's broken today in the relationships between Black people and white people, or melanin enhanced and melanin challenged people, that causes us not to really be able to be our authentic selves in public with everyone. Right? We all need this healing. So that's something we're trying to work on, providing opportunities for these, as Dr. Eric Law from the Kaleidoscope Institute calls, gracious spaces, not just safe spaces to have these conversations and healing, but gracious spaces where everyone feels like they can be vulnerable. We really only heal when we can be vulnerable and accept help, accept knowledge of what has happened in the past, and acknowledge what's happened in the past, and together find a way to move forward in the future.
Dwight, anything you'd like to add to that?
Yes, thank you, Melanie. I agree with everything James said, but I'd like to add that the description of the Black male, the Black race in general, is would also include irresponsible and unintelligent. And those are things that are being propagated and promoted, especially in the last 8 years or so. Some of it may be a backlash to President Barack Obama and the light that he brought to this country. And some of it is just a residual from the Civil War. I can tell you this, that I'm not shocked at what has happened, but I am deeply surprised at the speed at which so many things that have been accomplished, so many milestones that have been passed, were reversed. Like Roe versus Wade. I mean, so many, many things. And it is disheartening, But we know as descendants of slaves, even in the darkest hours, we can put out victory, and we will put out victory. And it won't be just for people of color. It will be for this entire nation. Black people love this country, and this we just want this country to love us back.
Wow. JerriAnne Boggis, Executive Director of Black Heritage Trail in New Hampshire, Dwight Davis, owner, senior helpers of Southern New Hampshire, past president of Black Heritage Trail New Hampshire, and James McKim, NAACP Manchester Branch President and Managing Partner of Organizational Admission, LLC. Thank you all so much for joining us today. The conversation continues online. What do you think about Juneteenth? We'd love to hear from you. Visit our Facebook page at collaborativenh.org and use the hashtag JuneteenthNH. Thank you for watching. See you next time on The State We're In.